country. She's got a place in Tuscany as well. Aren't we lucky, though, to have homes all over the place? I think I am. My house in Switzerland, I think, is a place called Kloster. Do you know it at all? Do you know it? It's close to Zurich. I've been trying to say that for weeks. And I was a pioneer of the island of Mastique. I was about the first person to go to Mastique. I introduced little Princess Meg to Mastique. But I've been there more recently. It's not as nice as it was. Broken gin bottles on the beach. Cigarette butts everywhere. It's not the same. But Switzerland's lovely, and your little kids...
Very clean, isn't it?
Do you get around on skis here, or do you drive?
Oh, no, drive. Talk to me about that. No, no, I never learned how to drive.
You'd need a prescription windscreen, wouldn't you? The hill starts would be difficult.
That would be a big danger if I try to drive. I think I'm better off without driving.
You're better as a passenger.
Yes. Yeah.
Mama, I've got a little gift for you to add to your collection. Take those ones off and pop these on. These are Nana glasses. Oh. Yes, thank you. Nana Mouskouri. Looking beautiful. My next guest is a man. He's a film star, and he's best known for his biblical roles. Oh, wonderful, wonderful Bible films like The Ten Commandments, Sodom and Gomorrah, Ben-Hur, Earthquake. And the Colbys. So you might say I know him in the biblical sense. I'd like you to welcome the distinguished Charlton Heston. Oh, Chuck, darling. What's the matter with you?
It's ridiculous. I'm very embarrassed. I was playing tennis and I slipped. It's just a bad sprain. It's nothing. I've got a cast
on it.
Sorry,
my darling. I thought you were giving an Ironside in person.
I'll be right there.
No, don't move. Please. Sister Vegegood, we've got a trained nurse here, Chuck. No, up you go and please help Mr. Heston, will you, sister? Oh, help is coming, darling. I thought you brought your chariot with you at first. Up you go. She'll help you. Now, gently, gently. Take it very gently. The stairs are very, very...
Oh, Damon.
You'll be very, very pleased to hear that Charlton Heston, or Chuck as I call him, is as bright as a button and as fit as a fiddle. He's in a coma, that's right. Our Studio London Weekend paramedics tell me that he'll be right as rain for my next show. Isn't that lovely? So, it is going to be a girls' show tonight, and I want to introduce my third lady guest. She's certainly the best thing to have come out of Hungary since goulash. She's been keenly anticipated. We've been longing to have her, and at last she really is here. Your ovation, please, for Zsa Zsa Gabor!
break my neck. I came down without
you. You did. This way, my precious.
Thank you so
over
much.
Over here, my... Look at that beautiful frock. May I introduce Nana?
Hi, darling. Zaza, nice
Gigi, Jermaine. Zaza, Nana, Jermaine.
What name?
Madge, do sit down. A badge, Madge, a badge. I just have to pop
oh, my that goodness, day. Great. Well, Mother used to do that to us. She oh, never knew
one.
Which of her daughters
yes,
we are.
Another one.
Oh, no, no. You wore my dress.
No. There we are. Very good. Look at you. Oh, what a fabulous creature you are.
Oh,
I forgot to curtsy. I should.
Oh, my darling, thank you.
Is it proper? You're a princess, after
I
all.
Know,
aren't
I'm
you?
A duchess, but I don't feel it at all. I just feel like Zsa Zsa Gabor.
Well,
a house frau.
Oh, come on, darling. There you're putting yourself down again.
Not
you're
really.
Not a housewife.
Well, Bob Hope says every time I get divorced, I keep the house. So I'm a housewife. Oh, before you destroy me with my divorces and marriages, I want to tell you one thing. I made 50 movies. I played on Broadway to standing ovations, standing room only. I played Las Vegas. I make all this television and I'm self-supporting. And now destroy me, my love.
Destroy you? What sort of a monster do you think
I am? I know you're not a monster, but everyone always picks on my divorces and my marriages.
I'm not. I may touch upon you. I love the way this woman calls everybody darling, don't
That's
you?
That's me. I have to because I don't remember the names like you. So I say, darling, me, darling.
It's good. It's lovely. It's the way you say it with a K on the end.
What does that mean?
Will you say darling?
Darling.
I thought it, I didn't think it was darling at first. I thought it was some old Hungarian word. I want to know how you met your prince, Zsa Zsa. How
My
did you
prince.
Meet him, your present husband?
Yeah, that was something. I was perfectly happy in America, perfectly happily divorced. And I'm always happy when I'm divorced. It's a wonderful thing. It's wonderful to get married and divorced, two wonderful state of mind to be. It's a little different, but it's great. I love a divorce.
I've not had that experience. You know, I've been married to my husband, Norm, for, oh, so many years now.
Isn't that wonderful?
I think it is.
That's very lucky if you can stand one man so long.
Well, we've not been under the same roof a lot of the time.
That's why you're happily married. Being under the same roof as the same man more than 2 years is against my religion.
But, of course, you'd miss out on one thing. All those lovely anniversaries. I mean, ruby, silver...
Yeah, well, only if the stones are ruby, not just the word that I don't like. No, the ruby anniversary, which is the ruby? Which
well,
year? How many
I've
years?
Lost count. It's difficult in my husband's case. I mean, you're counting the number of anniversaries. I never know whether to count the periods of coma.
Is he a sick man?
Oh, sick.
And you have to support him?
Well, my husband is a registered charity, Charlie. Prostate suffering.
All,
have any of your hubbies had prostate problems?
I never give them enough time.
Norm. You know, my husband is deductible. If you we have a day in Australia, it's prostate day. The friends of the prostate go out and they rattle tins. Well, they're not tins, Jermaine, are they? They're sort of plastic prostates, rather like the tomatoes you see on restaurant tables. And people put money in them. It all goes to prostate research. We started that. I helped start it.
My goodness, you had to, my God, if he's sick so long. Oh, I can't even pronounce the name. It's awful. It sounds bad, that name.
It does. It's a mystery to we women.
And you're still
where the funny
you're...
little Cinderella organ is. This woman has had 9 highly successful marriages.
Eight. I don't think it was so successful. I just married 8 very famous men. And when they start to bore me, which happens very soon, unfortunately, I don't know why. You see, One needs, I actually should marry a woman because they are more exciting and more funny. And
I agree.
Because men, after a while, they're tired. I'm married now to a man who's younger than I am, but he's 100 years older than I am because he's always tired of sleep. That's terrible.
Is he? Does he have headaches at the crucial moment?
That's me who has the headache.
I don't believe that for a second, you darling. Well, I've seen that prince, and he's a spunky little number.
Very attractive, yes?
Very attractive.
All my husbands were very attractive.
Did any of these husbands of yours have anything in common at all? I mean, like a mole in the same place. I mean, I personally like a man with something in the same place.
The only thing they had in common, they were all good lovers. Because why should I marry him for other reasons?
Exactly.
No reason. I can support myself.
You've been married once before, haven't you, Nana?
Yes, I'm only once divorced.
Well, only once divorced and you never marry again?
No, I would like to get married. I hope I will.
One of my ex-husbands is free now and he's wonderful.
She's so attractive, isn't she?
Beautiful.
And I wouldn't be a divorce in your case.
She's so gorgeous. On television, you look fabulous. Yeah. You've walked out. You're absolutely fantastic.
You look gorgeous on television, Jermaine.
In life,
and who knows, in one day, you might look equally gorgeous in reality. No, you didn't. I was just thinking of a little Nana being divorced. I don't want to make a joke about it because, in a way, it's a tragic and yucky thing. Wouldn't be
a
divorce.
It happens to everyone.
It's a very tragic thing.
It'd be a Nana split. You know, you're telling me things. I have the feeling we've got such a lovely thing going. You're telling me lots of little intimate, lovely things you've probably never discussed
because you have such a wonderful way to get things out of people.
Oh, lovely. Thank you. I think I have too.
Yes.
You were married to someone by the name of Ryan. Now, that name doesn't... Was he just
Jack
a nobody,
Ryan.
This Ryan?
Oh, no. He is the one who invented the Barbie doll and the first missile.
Barbie doll? I thought Klaus Barbie invented it. In which case, he can't be punished enough, in my opinion.
The Barbie doll. I was his next door neighbor and I worked very hard those years and he gave these enormous parties with loudspeakers and horrible, and I kept on calling up the Bel Air Patrol to shut up that neighbor because I have to sleep, I get up early. So as he said later, I had to marry her to shut her up.
You married a lot of different nationalities, Zsa Zsa.
Yes.
Is there a nationality that you specially like?
Well, I was very happy with an Englishman, George. Mm. Conrad Hilton was American, and he was older than my grandfather.
And now you're married to a German.
Yeah.
Nationalities for you, your hubby, what was he, Nana?
I don't think that the nationality matters.
You don't?
Find,
no, not really. Okay. And in the people
and
that you
have to find the right person.
Which nationality was he there?
My first husband was Greek, of course.
Swiss men, do you see a lot of them?
Yeah, I see a lot of them, but I don't live with them.
The yodeling would be a nuisance, wouldn't it? Jermaine, your little preferences? Latin?
I think they're all good at different things, is the problem.
Yeah, once you have three husbands at the same time, I think that might work.
Actually, all I want is a very small husband.
A what?
Well, I'd like him to live in a cupboard. I'd like him to take care of the books.
You want a sort of curator.
Just a little useful, a gnome. A Swiss gnome might be nice. Are they really the people in Zurich? You'd know, being from close, as if they're real gnomes. Are they real gnomes?
I don't know. I have, of course, I go there a little bit to visit my money from time to time. But I'm interested to learn, you see, because in many, many ways you ladies are more experienced than me. Admittedly, I'm looking very sophisticated, but I'm a very inexperienced woman in the subjects that we've been talking about.
If your husband is so sick for all the time, that's terrible. Can't you have a love on the side?
A toy boy?
Do you think, Jermaine? I don't know. Look, It'd be awful, wouldn't it, if Norm found out?
But he doesn't have to find out if you do it right.
Oh. You think there'd be a way?
Of course there's a way. There's always a way. People all have a husband and I love him.
Well, we'll talk about it later, but I think... he speaks of you. Isn't this spooky? My husband, Norm, they rang me from the prostate clinic. All last night he was saying, Zsa, 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 Zsa. They ran through all your films, as many as they could get at video. You know, it wasn't you at all. His little saline drip jar was in. And he was pointing to saying, Zsa, Zsa. He could have dehydrated. Isn't it awful? A little earlier, you were saying that you liked women, and in a spooky kind of a way, and I don't mean this, this is not in a yucky way.
No.
You could marry a woman. I mean intellectually.
Everybody needs a wife, because a wife looks after you, is a good friend, can cook, helps you with your life. It's really true.
You're not suggesting playing hospitals with a person you're own.
No. I like man. I love man. There's no way out. But do they really?
They can cook.
Yes. Yeah, but they won't do it. The moment you marry them, they won't cook. Before you marry them, they can cook.
But they can, I think. Sometimes they can.
Men can cook better than women, actually.
Much better.
But you have to make such a song and dance about it. They cook something, you have to salaam and praise them and all that jazz. They won't just put the food on the table. They've got to have the apron, the number, the special tools, and all
that. Exactly. Here, here. And Jermaine, who does the washing up afterwards? We always have to clean up.
No, but there's a machine now, you know, you put everything in it. Wash up dishes, that's art. I cook, but wash dishes, that's really terrible.
What's your favorite dish, possum?
Possum?
Possum. What? It's possum. Australian for darling.
Yeah, my favorite dish is... I don't really have a favorite dish, but I cook one dish, which everybody ever cooked it for marries me right away. And that dish is... it's called the Dracula goulash. It is made with... It is fantastic.
It's Dracula goulash?
It's called Dracula goulash. It comes from Dracula land, which is next door to Hungary.
The Carpathian Mountains.
Carpathian. Look how wonderful you know everything. Isn't that crazy?
Well, I know a little bit about a lot of things I do. How could we help Madge? I mean, this woman has been widowed for many, many years. Yes. You think if we gave her some of your goulash, it could help her?
I think what she needs is a good man, actually.
That's a very short-sighted man. I mean that nastily, Madge. I mean that caringly. Have you any advice to wannabes? Do you know what wannabes are?
No.
Do you know what wannabes are, Jermaine?
Somebody who wants to be someone.
There are a lot of wannabe Ednas around, you know. They're little kiddies to whom I am a role model. Isn't that wonderful?
Wonderful.
And there are wannabe Nanas, I know that. Yeah. Wannabe Jermaines. No wannabe Madges, I'm afraid. But wannabe Jarjars. People... who've looked to you, quite rightly, as a very fine example of your type.
Shall I be insulted
no,
by that?
You
really a very simple woman. You can't imagine
darling,
the simpler.
What advice would you give to these kids?
To the kids, that when they get married and they get divorced, they should give back the ring, they must give back the ring, but keep the stone.
Sharp as a tack. I've loved this. Spookily enough, we've been chatting away. We haven't even thought about the time. We've been communicating not just with words, but with our juices, with our drives, with our little vibes, our little electrical feminine vibrations. Now I'm here to do something. I always end one of my lovely shows, Zsa-Zsa.
You are lovely, let me say.
Thank
that.
You.
Really, you
and
are.
So are you.
Thank you.
In fact, I could gobble you up. Dracula goulash. You want that recipe after the show?
I will send it to you.
I always end with a little song, don't I? And I've written, well, I haven't written a song. I've written new words to an old song. Remember that Irish eyes are smiling?
Of course I do.
Well, I'm not to sing it now. I'm not going to ask you to help me, but you can join in at the end, Germaine and Zsa-Zsa. But I'm dedicating this song to Nana in a way to about you, Possum. So I'd like you to join me in front of Laurie Holloway and the Hollow Tones. You girls can creep in later, just at the end. Because this is a song that I've dedicated to Nana Muscuri's face furniture. You'll see what I mean in a moment. When Grecian eyes are smiling through a pair of plastic frames, I smell a whiff of old moussaka at the first Olympic game.
Och nu tar Dame Edna emot kvällens gäster som är skådespelaren John Mills och Rudolf Nureyev.
Wherever the eyes of the world are focused, wherever history is in the making, she is there. Organizing events, guiding those new to the limelight. Bringing openness to those who shape the destinies of the planet. In the corridors of power, behind closed doors, she is the one that leaders follow. Jetting around the world to bring words of comfort to the bewildered. Ever ready to share herself with her public, she'll even give up her Sundays to bring color to our lives. Interrupting her busy schedule to be with us tonight, ladies and gentlemen, Dame Edna Everidge.
Wonderful, wonderful, legendary miniseries, The Dame Edna Experience. I could have done many, many more. I could have. But London Weekend couldn't afford it. It is simple, I'm afraid. But, of course, I think 6 legendary shows are better than 106 merely magnificent ones. I'm right. And, you know, medical people have warned me that there's going to be a massive outbreak of PEDS when this show is over. Do you know what PEDS is? Well, it's a little medical term. P-E-D-S. It's post-Edna Depression Syndrome. What happens to people when I'm off the air for about 5 minutes or out of the headlines? But I want you to carry on regardless. Life is worth living. I can't be around forever, possums. I can't. I wish I could, but I can't. I'm sorry. And sure enough, there'll be someone filling my slot when I'm gone. But there will. I want you to draw whatever meager nourishment from that you can. Now, the group most affected by post-Edna Depression Syndrome are the biggest group that watches me, my biggest audience, the growth industry, yuppies. Yuppies! I'm not quite sure what that means. I know I'm the femme fatale of the Philofax fraternity, so I ought to know this. I think it's young, unattractive parents without partners. I think that's what it means. Of course, I am a yummy, aren't I? Which is a youngish, upwardly mobile mother and megastar. And I have a marvellous, marvellous little lineup of guests tonight. I have the first guest on my wonderful, wonderful show tonight is Sir John Mills, and he is a frothy, which is a fabulously regal old thespian. My next guest is Cynthia Payne, who's a hussy. That means a happily unmarried, sympathetic old sex pot. And my big star tonight is Rudolf Nureyev, who's a droopy. A dancing Russian with overwhelmingly obvious personal proportions. I mustn't, however, forget my little old friend and bridesmaid, Madge Alsop. Hello, Madge. Hello. How are you, darling? Hello, Possum. Poor old Madge, she's a bit of a spooky, isn't she, really? It's a self-pitying, odorous old killjoy, aren't you? Spooky, that's my word, isn't it? It's really the inward spooky. I started it sweeping the world like Dutch elm disease. Don't be caught not saying it. Let's hear you all say spooky. 1, 2, 3.
Spooky.
Lovely. Well, my first guest, Possums, tonight is someone that London Weekend... Well, they tried to stop me having on the show. It's as simple as that, I'm afraid. When I suggested that I wanted this guest along, they said, no way. That tired old phrase, I hate that expression, no way. I said, no way, no way. I want Cynthia Payne. I want Cynthia Payne. I don't think I'm the first person to have said that. Because, Possums, I'm not just an actress. I'm not. I'm a social anthropologist. Call me old-fashioned if you like, that's what I am. And it is my duty to probe, swab, and if necessary, smear my hair. I'm going to subject little Cynthia to the most extensive probing that little mite has ever had. I'm going to subject her to the Dame Edna experience. What has that woman been guilty of? What? I read in my little documents that they gave me the little brief. So she'd been guilty, accused of nothing more than running a disorderly house. Good heavens above. I mean, you could put every woman behind bars for that, couldn't you? I mean, we don't all like hoovering, do we? For heaven's sake, we could all be on trial, couldn't we? So I want her now. Your applause, please, for Madam Cynthia Payne. You're looking as pretty little pink mite you are too. Gorgeous frock, sweetheart. Yeah. Make yourself at home.
A dress, Dame Edna, not a frock, is a very old-fashioned
thing. Is it? I'm sorry, it's an Australian expression for a dress. Oh. Gorgeous, Cynthia. Badge, please, Madge. I have put little badges on my guests in case I forget their names. Thank you. There we are. A little badge. Synth. Couldn't fit Cynthia on. My darling. Did you hear what I was saying? I mean, all this yucky old publicity, aren't people awful? They can destroy anyone's reputation. I've heard the rumours about me have been hair-raising enough. Yes, they get back, and you're a very ordinary-looking mite. You're the sort of woman I wouldn't mind borrowing a cup of sugar from. I wouldn't. People silly, particularly in this country. What can I smell?
Mm-mm. Well, it's my favourite perfume, actually. It's called Maya, and it's a Spanish perfume.
Oh, is it, darling?
The men say it's sexy, but the women don't like it.
Well, I wouldn't be responding to that, would I, darling? But it smells very, very, well, unusual. Maya, it's Spanish, is it? Have you just bought it, have you?
No, I've had it for 20 years, this perfume.
20 years you've been wearing it, have you? Madge has got some scent that I brought back duty-free about 20 years ago. She's Charlie, it's called. Can you smell her, Charlie, from where you are? I think it's gone off. It smells a bit like fly spray at the moment. You know, we've got a bit in common, Cynthia, my darling, because I'm a talk show hostess and you're a sort of a hostess. I think you provide a need, don't you? Because as far as I can gather, you have these parties and things. Am
yes,
I
that's
barking
right.
up the right track there?
Yes, well, I love my parties. It's really, to me, it's like arranging a stage show.
I know the feeling there, darling.
I bet you do.
Tell me, when you have your little parties, or when you did in your lovely home where you're still living in one of the delightful, more upmarket suburbs of London, more the Australian type of suburb. It's a two-storey home, by the way, isn't it, darling?
It's a detached. Two-storey.
Oh, lovely, in its own grounds.
But the noise doesn't come out the walls.
The noise, no. Well... food. Do you provide people with a little supper?
Oh, yes, we have plenty of drink. And it's mainly salmon and cucumber sandwiches because I haven't got a lot of time to do
hot
food.
But you slice the cucumbers, I hope. Yes, I think so. I think people carry do-it-yourself a bit far sometimes. They do. But as far as I can... What's the matter with this audience? You see?
I don't understand.
People are spooky, aren't they? As far as I can gather, darling, they're more or less a sort of a fancy dress affair, is that right?
Well, it's like a fantasy party. I mean, I think we all have to get out of our real selves and live in a fantasy world now and again.
This woman lives in a fantasy world. That's what it's doing, Cynthia. You could probably help this creature.
Probably could.
Tell me, why did the police raid you? I heard this horrible story of the police flooding into your home.
Don't really know. I think somebody must have been jealous of me.
You think so?
I think so.
Well, I think, wouldn't some people like dressing up? How do you know they were the police? There might have been people just dressed up, Cynthia.
Well, they've got to go some to fool me if they were dressed up.
My darling girl, you know,
excuse me, they could only come in as a normal man, otherwise I'd sniff it out.
I'm sorry?
Transvestites to get in my house.
I'm not. What is a transvestite? I thought, is it?
A transvestite is somebody that likes to dress up in female clothes to get out of their. They don't want to do it for long. They don't want to do it for a day, maybe only a few hours. But just, they say, they tell me it's a release of the mind. You can't understand that.
Call me old fashioned, Cynthia. Troubled souls there are in the world. Now, this is me being a bit upfront now, and I have to say this about myself. I don't know whether you agree with it or not, but to me it's not a big part of life, this SEX.
I must agree with you. It doesn't worry me much now.
I mean, I can take it or leave it, Cynthia, frankly.
Like a cup of tea to me.
Like a what? A
cup of tea to me.
Like a cup of tea. Well, it's not exactly like a cup of tea to me.
I must say, when I was young, it was different. But my age, our age, we can, you know, do without it.
Well, I think you can't have a cup of tea in the dark, can you, darling? Dunking is difficult, isn't it? Dunking.
I've never heard of it.
Well, you put it in, but a bit can drop off. That's all. Talking to you, possum. Now, you have a new enterprise, a publication coming out. What's it called?
Yes, it's coming up at the end of this month, and it's called Entertaining at Home by Cynthia Payne.
Oh, how exciting, Cynthia. Be a lovely family Chrissy present, won't it?
Yes. It's meant in time for the Christmas stocking, and it's a fun book.
Oh, lovely. Well, I wish you luck with it. It might even win a prize.
Never know.
The Hooker Prize. Cynthia Payne. What a merry little mite. As I was chatting to her, my mind was starting to stray a little bit. What a lot of subjects we covered, didn't we, Cynth? We did. I like a bit of girls' talk, but I'm suffering from the jitters. Not exactly the jitters, but first night nerves. Do you know why? Because the first night ever to have tripped down those stairs and joined me on this lovely show is about to come before you. He was a beacon of talent in the dark years of the Second World War. He's the father of our very much loved Hayley Mills. He's one of the busiest actors on the planet. Your ovation for distinguished little Sir John Mills. John, may I introduce you to Cynthia?
Cynthia
Payne,
how do you
Sir John Mills, Madge. Madge, also my bridesmaid. Thank you, woman. Now,
Dame Edna, I hope you'll forgive me if I seem very, very nervous tonight.
Don't be nervous with me.
Well, I am, because I've really been a tremendous fan of yours for years. My whole family have. And Haley and Juliet and Jonathan and Mary, my wife, we've watched your career for years. I'm really terribly thrilled to be here so close to you. In the flesh.
We're going to get closer and closer to you. I'm thrilled to have you on the show too, because in a spooky kind of way, I think you won the Second World War single-handed. Miss Payne here, little Cynthia.
Yes.
She's affiliated with our entertainment industry own way.
Yes.
I don't know whether I should say this, darling, but she's been described as running a house of ill repute, a highly reputable house of ill repute.
Really?
But you wouldn't know anything about that, would you, darling?
Well, as a matter of fact, I do know a little about it.
What way?
Yes, is this confidential?
Of course, this is between ourselves.
Yes, well,
go no further, viewers.
Well, I was very young. At the time, I was about 19. It's several years ago now, and I was on tour in the Far East with a company called The Quince, and
The Quince. The Quince.
Yes, The Quince. And we were a very strange little lot, and we played all sorts of plays, Hamlet and Julius Caesar and musical comedy. Anyway, the night in question we're talking about, we were invited to go to a certain house. Perhaps ill repute. And I was 19 years old, and I went along, and I felt rather nervous, and we ushered in, and Madame said, look, if you come into this little room here and sit down, and you look at the mirror here, it's a double-way mirror, they can't see you, but you can see them, and you look through, and you'll find something very, very entertaining going on. I looked through the mirror, and the door opened in the room, and a very attractive young lady came in and in a very nice dressing gown and undid the top button and then sat on the bed. And a young man came in, and he came right up to the window, and he looked in the window and went like that and stared straight at us, of course not being able to see us. And I looked at the company and looked at him, and it was our juvenile lead.
How embarrassing, darling. Oh, luckily, Sir Lawrence has managed to live that down.
I didn't mention his name.
You are very popular in Australia, Sir John Mills. Can I call you Johnny?
Well, I'd be very, very flattered.
Please call me Edna. Edna.
Oh, may I really? Thank you very much, Edna.
Let's drop the honorifics.
Yes.
But you never stop working, of course, and your family's the same, a showbiz family. Is there any rivalry within the family?
No, I don't think so, no. We've all worked together, and it's all been very satisfactory, really. Haley was a strange one. When I made Tiger Bay with her, I knew that what the press would say. They would say that, you know, I was wiped off the screen by my daughter. I knew that for sure. And I was. I mean, she was wonderful.
Well, you know,
absolutely marvelous. And on Sunday morning at the farm, I went to look for the Sunday papers to see what the notices were like, and I couldn't find them. And Haley had hidden them under the cushion on the couch.
Isn't that lovely? We've always adored her, and you are our first family in the theatre, very much so. But I wish I'd had such an easy, trouble-free ride with my own daughter, Velma, Johnny.
Yeah, Velma's been a problem, has she?
She's been a nightmare from time to time.
Is she drinking still?
Well, on the Valium bottle it says, take with liquid.
Well,
no, you shouldn't. She does it in defiance. I made the mistake, Johnny. Opposing her. You see, it's difficult, Cynthia, when you're a megastar.
Yes.
Because it's a role model. They have the terrific problem of living up to you all
of course,
it's very, very difficult for her. Dame Edna's daughter. It's always been along. She's got three little beautiful kiddies, Mervyn there. I've sent them all to Switzerland. They're at school in Switzerland, the kiddies. She gets on with her act. She's into flotation therapy. She's floating in a tank. She's finding herself.
Is her acne better?
No, it's worse. It's terminal. The primal screaming. I said,
really?
And I said, look, by all means, find yourself. The problem is, she sometimes does. That's it.
Yeah.
Rebirthing too. She's into every fad. She's got a boyfriend much older than herself. Yeah. With a ponytail, isn't that pathetic?
With a ponytail?
And he's bald, so it's...
Really?
It's really just like a yucky bit of skin with an elastic band around it. I don't know what, looks like a pocket old balloon 6 months after a party. You must know what they look like, sir. I have to say this, you're a very attractive man. Very, very spunky little mite, you know. And this man, I can say it, I hope you don't mind me saying it, it's in Who's Who for all to read, you're nearly 80 years of age.
Right.
Something to be proud of. Never considered retirement, I suppose, Johnny.
No, I think that's a dirty word. Would you retire, Dame Edna?
No, I'm sorry. I wouldn't.
No, I wouldn't. I couldn't dream of it. I think there's no point in retirement. I mean, we're both very lucky doing the things we like to do, aren't we? Don't you think?
I think Dame Nature, I'll say this, Dame Nature's given us all in her own ways a gift, a precious gift.
Yeah.
Well, she's given you a semi-precious gift, Cynthia. A precious gift of entertaining people, and I think it's our duty to pass it on. Sorry, but I do.
I think
sorry.
So,
yeah. Call me old-fashioned.
Yeah.
I don't even believe in dying, frankly.
No.
I'm into cryonics. Do you know what that is?
Cryonics.
They snap freeze you. They do.
Really?
Yeah. Yes, I put tenders out. Bird's eye and Findus are both completely. Cynthia, would you ever consider retiring, my love?
Retiring? No, I'd like to be an MP. Before I die.
Oh, would you?
No.
I'd like to get our stupid sex laws changed in this country.
The sex laws?
Mm. Any constituency you have in mind?
I would like, before I die, to be made a Dame of the Empire. Or other
I
than
think
that...
there's not much hope of that.
Well, if not, I'd like to be Chief Whip.
You're adorable. I'm sure you could. I'm sure if need be, you could turn your hand to anything, Cynthia. So you wouldn't go back to a proper job at all. What did you used to do before you were an actor?
What did I do? Well, I did several things. I was an office boy, a cleaner. And the most dreadful job I ever had was to sell lavatory paper. That was very, very difficult.
Thank goodness you don't have to do that anymore, darling.
The demonstrations were so tricky.
We know of you as a continuing ornament to our theatre and our movie world.
Fair.
I mean that. And then you were early on a door-to-door salesman. I'm still got a little gap there. Let's go back to the late 1930s.
Late 1930s.
Before the war, before those famous films. What did you do then?
Well, I was a hoofer.
What?
A hoofer, a dancer.
Were you?
Yes, a dancer. And I started in musicals, in the back row of the chorus, and I learnt my dancing from a marvellous coloured dancer. And I did about 7 years of musical comedies. And I loved every minute of it. It was marvellous.
I've got a little bit vague now because when I was a very, very young woman, we had these 78 records. That's before tapes and compact discs and things. And I had a record of a song. It was a duet. One of the singers was a person called Frances Day. Did you know a girl called Frances?
I knew Frances Day.
Frances Day.
Frances Day, yes.
Frances Day.
Right.
And I stand corrected. And the other was John Mills. Now, I always thought it was another John Mills because somehow the voice wasn't in uniform. Do you know what I mean?
But, Dame Edna, you're too young to
I was very young and I had that record as a bubba and I played it. It was gorgeous and I ought to know it by heart. It was a
review.
Little...
Yes.
It was out of a show, and it was called A White, A Little White Room.
Little White Room.
Little White Room. Do you remember it?
Well, it's something like it's over 45 years ago.
45?
Well, I'd have a crack at it. Do you know some of the...
I think I know it almost off by heart. Come on.
Well, let us try. Right. Every little mouse has got a house, and every bird a nest.
That's it.
But we've nowhere to rest our head. Be the right room, a room for you and me.
Isn't this gorgeous? We want a little bright room, as bright can be.
To sit and watch the seagulls.
Those darling little seagulls.
But whether he or she gulls, we never could agree. A night room. We only want the bright room with a window by the sea. With a window by the sea.
Me, I loved singing that little duet. It could be a chart buster, couldn't it?
It's a nice number, isn't it?
It is a very warm and lovely number.
You remembered it, too.
1930, most of
Fantastic.
It, I did. My husband and I used to sing it, Little White Room, and spookily enough, he's ended up in a little white room. My next guest is a bit of a surprise. It's my manager, Barry Humphreys. He's a cheeky person, a small print in that contract of mine with London Weekend Television, and he wrote in there without me noticing that he had to be one of the guests on this miniseries. Some people say Barry Humphreys is a comic genius, a giant of world satire. Some say he was the first person to teach Australians to snigger at themselves. Personally, I'm sorry, possums, he leaves me cold. I'm sorry, call me. Call me old-fashioned if you like. To comply with my contract, I have to introduce him. So without any further ado, clap if you feel like it. Barry! Have to abort Barry Humphreys then, but I'm sorry, such is the technology on my set. He gets 10% of my income, but he got less than that of my show, didn't he? He was on long enough anyway, possum. And now a real man, not a foppish phony. A man who could leave his point shoes under my bed anytime he I saw him in Melbourne dancing to the strains of Dame Margot Fontaine. Your bouquets, please, for Rudolph and Nurier!
Thank you.
pass off my bridesmaid. Gorgeous. Oh, make yourself very much at home, you handsome devil. You know, something I've always wanted to know, my darling Rudolph. How did you get that sexy little scar on your lip?
It was a matter of honor. I was promised I could dance the role of the corsair. Then the director changed his mind, so I challenged him to a duel. We fought with the rapiers, and he hit me here. And that made me angry. I'm tartar, you know. So I ran him through like shish kebab.
Darling, is that true?
No. Really, it was a dog.
A dog? You fought a duel with a dog?
Oh, don't be stupid. Dog bit me. I was a little boy, and I was very thin. He thought I was a bone.
Well, I'll take that with a grain of salt, but I find that very attractive, that little scar on your lip, Rudy. I do.
But it is there for a purpose. You remember the story of Jacob and Angel?
No.
Jacob was perfect. And he was beautiful. God decided to give him a scar because he was too perfect. It's the same with me.
What refreshing modesty. Tell me, darling, to keep as gorgeous as that, do you have a daily routine at all?
This morning I got up at 6 o'clock. Then I went back to bed again till 10. I got into my practice clothes. And I was at the bar for 4 hours. But this is England. The pub closed at 2:30.
What about your health routine, Sir John?
Well, I'm pretty strict. I take it very calmly. And I get some exercise, and we'll do some yoga and some exercises. And have lunch and all put my feet up after lunch for an hour, if I possibly can. And then the show, and I find everything's aimed at 8 o'clock in the evening. I think the day is just nothing until you get to 8.
Putting your feet up's important. I think you learnt that early on, didn't you?
I'm afraid I'm not so disciplined. I mean, I don't get much up out of bed before 10:30. And then I have 7 cats to look after. They're mostly strays, so I spend a good hour feeding those. And then I go out in the afternoon and look around the Oxfam shops to see if I can see any bargains. But this last year's been a bit hectic for me, so I haven't been able to do any of these things.
Well, you're looking very fit on it, my darling. Afterwards, I'm having a late-ish night, aren't I? We're having a little candlelit supper out at my place.
I like Russian specialities.
Russian specialities.
Toad in the hole. Bubble and Squeak, and spotted Richard.